Well, hello my YouTube friends and family. So today we're working on lot 28. These are 10 books for $2. They're 20 cents each is what it breaks down to be. And they're romance novels. I've got lots. So that's why I'm making lots of them. So anyways, you can get a hold of me through Midness Bookstore and more at Facebook, or you can email me and everything will be in the description below. And if you're new to YouTube, it's the little arrow up in the right-hand corner that you click, and it'll do a drop-down list, and you scroll down, and you'll see all my information. So with that, we will get to book number one. This is actually, some of these are old and very well-loved, so you will see some, looks like a sticker, and some of the titles rubbed off. This is actually called Expensive Pleasures by Stephen Lewis. This is a 1981 novel. It's a little bit of writing right there. Somebody read it in 84. But these books have withstood the test of time. Everyone wore her designer jeans, envied her extravagant lifestyle. Only a few knew the price she paid for her expensive pleasures. Kara fulfilled her wildest dreams as a superstar model. Aided by a publicized love affair, she indulged in one more fantasy to succeed as a fashion designer. Her inspired designs and transcontinental romances carried her to the apex of fashion industry and high society. But behind her public smile hid a private pain of lovers lost in a lost world of diamond-studded decadence, sexual abandon, and betrayal. Her name, face, lifestyle, and label were destined to become an exotic status symbol for America. But would all her fantasies come true? Would all the risks be worth those expensive pleasures? So there's book number one. Sounds interesting. Book number two is called The Branding Iron by Catherine Nguyen Burt. And this book's got some crinkling on it. Lots of some writing. Looks like somebody scribbled out their last name. A little bit of writing there. So we will do a flip through and some writing back there. But still, the whole story's there. So this says, where fame and fortune worth the terrible price she'd had to pay. When Joan Carver, a passionate and primitive mountain beauty, marries Pierre Landis, a handsome rancher, she feels happiness for the first time in her life. But her hidden talents and yearning for education antagonize Pierre, and his abusive jealousy drives her from him. Alone and wounded, she is rescued by Prosper, a stranger and sophisticated man who introduces her to an alien world of glamour and culture. Prosper's worldliness, strangeness, and his passion for Joan make life too complicated, and she runs away again, this time to a life of fame and fortune on the stage. But Pierre's memory haunts her, and success with Prosper cannot overcome her intense and painful longing for the man she married long ago. A stirring adventure of high passion and romantic suspense. That sounds sad, but good. Looks like it's been like taped too. It almost looks like it's been a library book. It's got the things on it, but still, it looks like a good book. Book number three. This is called Firstborn by Doris Mortman. This is actually a 1987. It's got a little tear right there, a little wrinklage. Very soft. You could tell it's been bent up and read a lot. And there's what the book looks like. This is the inside of the book. And this is what it's about. The first-rate, magnificent saga of a novel. Spanning 20 tumultuous years in moving from the glittering world of Paris high fashion to the headquarters of a luxury hotel conglomerate, from the set of primetime TV sizzler to a major Senate race, Firstborn unfolds the lives of four fascinating women whose destinies compel them toward a violent clash of ambition and love. Heated, dazzling, and tantalizing, filled with romance, intrigue, and suspense, it shouldn't be missed. A fabulous novel. And there's the cover. There's number three. Here's number four. Number four is called Whispers of Passion by Sandra Dubé, and this is a 1989 novel. It's got a little bit of rating right there. You can tell it's very well loved. And this is what this is about. Sweet, sweet Jasmine, the peaceful idol of lovely Jasmine Dupree's youth is shattered when she's sent away from her beloved home of Virginia to France, where a brilliant marriage has been arranged. Torn from the arms of Barrett Paxton, the man she loves, Jasmine is desolate, though her mother holds before her the prospect of great wealth and prestige that she will be hers as the wife of Marquis de Saint Antoine. Antoine. Jasmine discovers that her aristocratic husband to be a cold, harsh man who's been banished from Versailles to his remote, dreary chateau. She soon becomes an innocent and helpless pawn in the debauched schemes of her lascivious mother. Driven by loneliness and anguish, attempts to escape the chateau and return to Barrett. Her dazzling beauty makes her the focus of many men's desires and earns her the undying enmity of the most powerful woman in the French court, a woman who is capable of destroying Jasmine's dreams of happiness with the one man who inflames her body and soul with whispers of passion. Looks like there's a little bit of a watermark right there. Down there. But one thing about all my books is I do go through them so you will not have missing pages. And the next one is called Sunrise by Grace Livingston Hill, and this is a 1937. Look at that, age pages. And then this is a flip through of this one. I love yummy books like that. And that's my post-it note for receipts. And this is the back. Sunrise, accused of a theft he did not commit, a wild, handsome boy runs away to sea, only to find salvation in memory of a young girl's shining love. Grace Livingston Hill, the author of more than 50 books that are read and cherished by millions. Grace Livingston Hill is noted for bringing exciting drama and unforgettable stories and a sense of soaring spirit to her great novels of romance. How sweet is that? And then we have book number six. This looks like a really good book to like to cover. This says The Passing Bells by Philip Roth. This is a 1978. Look at the font style on that book. Isn't that pretty? It's even got a little crease of a bend. This is what the book looks like, and this is what it's about. From the well-kept lawns, rich woodlands, and gracious halls of Abingdon Priory, from the elegant charm of summer in London's Park Lane to the devastation of your person, the horrors of Gallipoli, the story of the Grevilles, two generations of a titled British family and their servants, men and women who knew their place upstairs and down until England went to war and the whole fabric of British society began to unravel and change. The Passing Bells is a story so vivid, so charged with life that it will carry you effortlessly into its own time. You will come to know people you will never forget. You will wish their story would never end. Swift and startling power, moving, entertaining, can absorb you in its fictional landscape as easy as Alice passing through the looking glass. Sounds like a good one. Then we have number seven. This one's called The Passionate Heart by Iris Bancroft. This is in 1983. Put some writing there. What the book looks like. And this is what it's about. His armies had brought death to her parents and an unknown fate to her fiancé. Her idyllic childhood home, Sumatra, was in the grip of invaders, her virgin body conquered, enslaved to his lust. He had taken everything from her, including her honor. Yet for all this, Marjorie could not hate Byron Scott, for he was no longer a child and an English captain brought to her ecstasies beyond her most secret dream. My Enemy, My Lover is what it's called. Sounds interesting. Then we have number eight. This is a 1981 For Richer, For Poorer by Edward Stort. This is the cover. It's got some writing in it. This is what it looks like. With me, you're always going to know what your books are going to look like. It says, Kitty had two sons. One was her secret lover, a rebel killed leading a strike against the old dynasty of John Stokes Sr. The other was by John Stokes Jr., the husband she seduced into believing both sons were his own. The husband who made her, Kitty Kellogg Stokes, the most powerful woman in the dazzling world of New York and Washington society. One son made her heir, the other victim of her revenge, but Kitty was to discover in her proud hearted sons, the only two men she could not deceive or control and be forced to make the cruelest decision any mother has ever faced. That sounds interesting. And then we have number 9. This is called Duchess. This is a novel by Josephine Edgar. It is in 1976. And then this is some writing in it. This is what the book looks like. And this is what it's about. She came to London to work in an elegant Victorian department store, but no one could keep the magnificent, impetuous Viola behind a counter. Soon she was in the arms of Lord James Stofrey, entangled in splendid, heated love affair that could only bring tragedy to a girl of her class. There are three other men who also love Viola, powerful men whose passion for the determined Duchess will influence her destiny. Doesn't that sound interesting? And then last, number 10, we have Glenda. It's a 1979 novel by Susanna Lay. It's got a little tear right there, a little mark. And this is what the book looks like. So if you're into winter reading, here you go. Glenda was an outcast of society, the bastard daughter of a lavish lord and the object of desire of every man who ever laid eyes upon her. Her first lover was Philip, and willingly Glenda would have been satisfied with this proud and powerful Norman duke who ripped through her resistance, woke her womanhood, and rekindled a flame within her secret heart. She was never to forget, but her passionate journey had only begun. She had moved through the hands of a ruthless and tantalizing viral Knight Templar, a cruel and corrupt English prince, a merciless German master, a perverted Turkish sultan, a brutal army of nameless men who paid for her favors. But behind Glenda's violent and perilous odyssey was an overwhelming sexual craving for Philip, and she would take the most fearful, degrading risks to be reunited in an exquisite tenderness and wild, rapturous union with this one man whose burning love she could not live without. And even if you don't buy real books and you have Kindles and Nook or whatever you use, I prefer real books because that's just me. I will have the ISBN numbers listed below. So if any of these books I read you're interested in, you could look them up and find them on your whatever you device you use. So that's another good thing too. And some of these books are older, so they might not have an ISBN number. So you can look them up by the title of the book and the name of the author. And that will be listed in my description below too. So with that, you guys have a great day. And thank you for spending your time with me and watching my videos. And if you like these type of videos, like, share, and subscribe. And you guys have a great day. Bye. Mwah.